doer mentality. So
absolutely true, brother. Yeah, that analysis paralysis can eat a lot of folks. You know, yeah, I think some. I mean, everybody in their own journey. Everybody got their different places that they are, and sometimes there are some folks who are trapped in that and don't even mind being trapped in that. So yeah, anytime I'm like, I lean more towards action myself, and you seem to as well. Mm-hmm. Man, we live right now, my brother Cam. What's up? We live.
How you doing, man? How you doing? I'm super excited.
I'm excited about this too. Let me introduce, you know, the podcast and what we're doing here. What's going on? I'm Courtney Rollins with the Life in Transitions Experts podcast, host of this YouTube channel, Facebook group, the podcast, as I said. If you're in any of those spaces, would love for you to support by liking, subscribing. It helps us really reach a lot more people, because this Life in Transition Experts podcast is geared towards professionals who help people through big transitions in life, as well as you folks or people who are actually going through those big transitions, particularly probate and estate planning, and helping folks generate income and wealth and solutions, mainly through the real estate that's involved in some of those dealings, but also in other aspects and other areas. And one of my favorite things to do is have conversations with amazing practitioners. And today I'm excited because I have my man Cam up here, who is relatively new to the game, but is doing amazing work. And Cam, how do you pronounce your last name?
Thank you. Adesanya. So there's a UFC fighter. His name's Israel Adesanya.
Yeah.
No relation, but same last name.
Hey, Adesanya is awesome. It's awesome. Yo, we got Luke up here. This is awesome. I don't know what has happened, but usually when folks are chiming in the comments, I'm not able to see who it is. But I see my man Luke is up here. What's going on, Luke? We're going to be chatting a little later on. He's also another gentleman who's in the probate real estate space. Hopefully he'll jump on this and we'll chat with him as well.
Awesome.
But folks, this is my man. Usually I'm talking to folks, you know, just at different levels, different stages. And this is exciting because, Cam, man, how long have you been in this real estate world?
So I started of September of last year, not the last year, the year before, excuse me, because I forgot where it's before, but I started September of 2022, and I just been super blessed. Yeah, a few deals, and just, you know, very happy.
Oh, that's what's up, man. Yeah, so 2022, relatively new, man. So why real estate? Before that, just in case, I don't know if you are saying that you get a little bit of feedback on your end. So I don't know if maybe, you know, we're live here, so maybe you can adjust the microphone. If not, we'll work it out in post-production.
Could you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you well. I can hear you well. But I'll just say, my man Luke shared that there's a little bit of feedback coming on when you speak. But hopefully other folks out there can hear you, and we'll be able to clean it up in post-production regardless when we put it out for the YouTube channel. But yeah, man, why real estate? How did you get into the world of real estate?
So super funny story. I was actually have my CDL, and I was sitting in my work truck. I was on TikTok out of all things, just, you know, bored, passing the time. And wholesale real estate popped up 3 times in a row, to the point where I was like, I got to see what this is. I went to YouTube University, right? And I just started diving in, and I just was kind of hooked, but I still was kind of skeptical, right? So I called a real estate agent in my market. Her name's Kimberly Aponte. Okay. And, you know, she's family friend, and she's like, yeah, this is real. I want you to speak to my stepdad. I went over there for 6 hours, man, and I just absorbed everything that he was telling me, and obviously told me, you know, it's simple, but it's not easy. Like, you know, knocking on a bunch of doors and just getting in front of people, it's not easy. But he's like, I told you previously, I think you should get your real estate license. And at the time, I was like, I have my CDL. What do I need to get into real estate for? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was definitely an eye-opener. And it was all from a TikTok. Well, 3 TikToks in a row. Wholesale. I was like, is the universe trying to tell me something?
Right there. Yeah, right. Man, that's why it's important for all of us to be loud. You never know who you're chatting with, who you're speaking with. TikTok, mm-hmm. YouTube University, you know, the Max Maxwells, the Brent Daniels, the people who are being loud, even the folks who maybe don't have a large audience but are putting their life or their example out there. We never know. You never know who you're going to connect with and touch. And that's amazing, man. And it's my CDL license. That's not something for the light of heart. So you must be a hard worker, man. Where'd you get this drive to just like, you know, put in work when you see something that you want to go after?
So it's just kind of how I always been. I just been super like if I want something, I'm going to get it. You know, the universe conspires with people who go and do action. So I'm very much like, let me find as much information as possible. So sometimes I do get stuck in the analysis paralysis, but I like to learn. I like to go. Like if I fall off the only way you can learn is by riding the bike, right? So if you fall off, then you know not to do that again, right?
That's a great. So
the best
analogy,
teacher
man.
Is experience. The best Absolutely. Teacher is experience.
And most of us learn to ride bikes if we've had that experience is through when we're younger. And I love the analogy. Folks who are blessed enough to be able to walk, when a child who's blessed to be able to try to walk, attempt to walk, how many times do they fall? Do they stop and say, "Hey, nah, it's over. I'm just gonna ride this one out"? Nah, they keep on going. And don't even sweat
exactly.
it.
Exactly. So,
and do you have like a certain process that you go about to give yourself the opportunity to like, you know, get the education you need, because you don't want to go anything super blind, I imagine, but still not be stuck in analysis paralysis. What do you do to move forward?
I like to just make sure I'm absorbing. Like I do get, like I said, I do get stuck in that analysis paralysis, but then I just have a point where I'm like, well, I have to try it. You know, like the first time you make pancakes, it's like, well, I know it's not going to be perfect, but then after repetition, you just get better at it, right? So I'm big on like, let me absorb information. And, you know, we're in the information age nowadays. Nowadays, you can literally go on YouTube and just learn anything. You can become a mechanic on YouTube. So I recommend anything you want to learn, Google it. Get around the people and learn. There was a point where I was, when I first started, I was around like 3 to 4 networking events a day. I mean, a week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, like I was super immersive, like just making sure I'm around the right people and just making sure that I'm absorbing the right information. So when I do make these efforts, they're more calculated as opposed to like just kind of winging it, you know?
So they're like inform, ready, shoot, aim, but they're like, you at least have a general idea and direction based on like the folks you're surrounding yourself with. Yeah, Luke says the first pancake never comes out right. That is so true, man.
Exactly. analogy,
man. So I had two questions I wanted to go towards, but one, it reminded me of, I love Zig Ziglar when he was here, and he would say anything worth doing is worth sucking at first, you know, for a time being. If it's worth doing, it's worth sucking at, because you are going to not be great at it. But like you said, that repetition connects those neurons. You get around people. And it's an amazing thing. But far as like real estate, you said the real estate agent pointed you to a person who said to get your real estate license. Do you have your license now?
No, I don't. So he told me to get my license like before I even got my CDL. And I've had my CDL for about 6 years now. But he randomly told me, he's like, "Hey, Cam, like you're a salesman, like get your license." Because her stepdad is just like, you know, we're super close. We were super like close family friends at one point. And I mean, I'm still super close with her, you know. And he just kept telling me, like, "Cam, I think this is something, like, you know, you should get into." And I was, at the time, I was just like, "Nah, I'm all set. I just kept saying it. And even his girlfriend at the time, Lisa Robinson, she was kind of reiterating the same thing. Like, "Hey, you guys are going to Foxwoods, you know, spending money. Why don't you guys invest into something that we're doing?" And at the time, we were like, "Nah, we're good. And, yeah. Kind of regret it, but hey, we're here now.
Hey, so there's so many different ways though that you could make money and add value and support people in real estate. Just like Luke just asked, he's asking, did you grab the license, which you answered, but you focused on wholesaling. Sounds like you are. Why wholesaling, and how'd you choose that as a a niche, and then we're going to go deeper into a deeper niche that you've chosen in wholesaling. But why
wholesaling? So the reason why I chose wholesaling, it was just like the first step stone to get in the game. And I didn't really know that at the time. I was just more or less just like, all right, what am I going to do to position myself around the people? Well, bringing the deal and bringing, that's bringing value to people. Like, I have the time, well, more time than them, and they have the money. So if I just collaborate with them, then it just works easier, you know? Mm-hmm. And the way I figured out how to wholesale was, again, YouTube.
Man, wholesale. So that's a wholesaling is one of the dispo strategies, but like the finding the deal is, I mean, that's essentially what all yep. real estate and all deals really is about, finding, sourcing the deal. So, yeah. So explain to us some of your journey, like some of your, like explain, give the audience an idea of.
It's bringing back, good memories.
You getting your first deal.
So, first deal, I was actually, it was in Lowell. After work, I was just knocking on doors at this point. And
I'm sorry, where?
It's Lowell. So, I'm from Lowell, Massachusetts.
Oh, Lowell, Massachusetts. I got you. Cool.
My name's Cameron Adesanya from Lowell, Massachusetts. Born in Boston, raised in Lowell. So, just driving around my area, because that's kind of the first thing they tell you. Just drive around your area and just, because you know, like the landscape, like, oh, people are more likely to buy over here as opposed to over here. So I found something in Lowell, and the guy was coming out with boxes. Like, he was coming out with a bunch of boxes, and I didn't think anything of it. I just blurted out to him, like, hey, I buy houses. No, hey, I wholesale houses. He's like, okay. After some rapport building, and I just, you know, just being direct at the point and just told him what I do, like, hey, I'm kind of new to this. I'm learning the curves. He was going through foreclosure, and it just meshed. Like, it was just, this was roughly a month and a half after I started. I didn't still know what to do at the time, so I referred it to a wholesaler. Mm-hmm. He gave me a referral fee. Now, it wasn't what he made, but it was just like the proof of concept.
I dig it.
And then I was like, okay, well, this is real. Okay. So now I'm going like, okay, how do I kind of hone in on this thing? Right. Mm-hmm. So again, I started knocking on doors, but this time I was leaving sticky notes as well. Bright pink sticky notes.
Yeah.
And I just, Cameron, my name's Cameron Adesanya. I'm a real estate investor. I would love to buy your beautiful home. And I would have my number at the bottom, and I went around dropping notes. So now I come across a property in Drakett, which is like, it's next door to Lowell, but it's a little more, you know, it's a little nicer. Mm. So lady calls me. She's like, hey, Cameron, you left the sticky note on my door. Long story short, I go over there. I take 200 pictures. Like, so many pictures, because now I'm like, okay, this one's mine. I'm going to capitalize off this one instead of just bringing it to another wholesaler. Now I know what to do at this point. I'm a little more confident. I know this is real. The hard part was just finding the end buyer. But mm-hmm. at this point, I wasn't going to networking events yet.
Okay.
So now this is, it's funny, because this is how I met the person that opened the door for the networking events. So I had it under contract, and it was too high for a wholesale, because me, I'm still learning my numbers. I'm still learning how to comp properties, looking at the sales prices, that kind of thing. So then I'm knocking on doors. I leave the sticky note. Lady calls me. I lock it up, too high for a wholesale, but it was low enough to where if it was on the MLS, it was a steal. Okay. But I didn't know this. Like, I'm not, you know, I'm still learning the game. So then I was shopping the contract, and I come across Sonia Provost. She opened the floodgates for my networking skills.
Shout out.
Super shout out, Sonia. She brought it to the property. She's like, Cam, this is a little too high, but if you could find, pointed me in the right direction as well. If you could find somebody who would live in this, then you have a really good deal. Hmm. So I just started brainstorming, and I was like, well, let me call a real estate agent. Circle back to Kim. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, Cam, this is exactly what I'm looking for. I don't know how the heck you found this property, but this is what I'm looking for. And she helped me navigate the sale. And yeah, that was my second wholesale. And at this point, I'm like, wow. Like, okay, now I'm like super confident. And at this point, all I need is like just basically my own network. So I started going to network. Well, Sonia, she's like, hey, Cam, because I, you know, talking to her, building rapport. Hey, Cam, I see you're newer at this thing. I think you should invite me to my first networking event where I actually met my first mentor. And boy, it was just, it was life changing. I just, being around people who want to learn and just feed into you, like, oh, you're new? All right, well, I think you should be doing this, and just giving you advice, right? Mm-hmm. And good advice at that, that people who have actually done these things. Shout out REI Ignition, right? And it just went up from there. I literally hit the ground running. I went to every networking event from Springfield to Plymouth to like Worcester to Manchester, New Hampshire to like, you know, like I was going all in. And yeah, sorry, little ramble, but I wanted to kind of paint the picture of my first couple deals.
That's great. A couple of nuggets that I'm saying is that, like, you know, again, you didn't necessarily have to know the three or four steps ahead. You just had to find out what was the next step, and you were willing to do that. And that's a wonderful thing. And also, well, I have two questions, but I'm gonna go with how did you? Well, when you're networking, do you go with a particular what is your angle?
Absolutely. I'm a big, like, I should have a big shirt thing on my shirt. YouTube University. Like, I would go on YouTube and just, how do I network properly? Like, how, like, and then I'm a people person naturally, but just, you are talking to people in a certain way, so it's like you just don't want to sit there rambling about your life story, right? So I would just Patrick Bet David on how to network. Then I would just go to every room and make sure I talk to every single person in that room, even if it's a 30-second conversation. Hey, my name's Cameron Adesanya. I'm a wholesaler in the area. How are you doing today? That's it. How did we meet? The first thing I did, I inboxed you. Networking is everything. If you have the network and the information and you can learn the deal flow, the money's going to come.
Oh, man. He said a word right there. And so your first referral, how do you remember how much that referral was?
It was $2,000.
$2,000. And then what about your first deal?
Like, it was $12,000.
Hey, there it is, man. So, but, you mean to tell me
people actually... It gets better. So, again, I'm super blessed. So then I end up meeting an attorney, and I spoke to her this morning, and she's just Veronica. Like, I love this lady. She she saw that I was a people person, and this was the deal that I was like, I know, like, this business, like, my skills is gonna set me apart in this business just because I'm a people person, right? Again, sorry. That's great, man. So we go down to, she's like, Cam, I'm gonna send you down to Maynard. I'm gonna give you a try. There's this lady, she has a situation where she doesn't know what she wants to do with the house, whether she wants to list it or sell it. I just want you to talk to her and just see, like, how she feels, right? So I go down there, and then, I mean, just me being a human, I'm like, well, what's wrong with her? Why is she selling? Well, her dad has dementia, right? So just anybody in that situation is like, oh, like, dude. So I get there. First thing she tells me is, like, she's a daddy's girl. Like, you know, obviously after, like, oh, who are you? You know, the basics. And she tells me she's a daddy's girl. That clicked in my head. Like, it's not even about the house. Right? It's about her situation. The only reason she's even selling this house is because her pops. So you know what I did? For an hour and a half, I sat there and talked to her about her dad. I sat there for probably 15 minutes after that just to take a quick picture of the house, get like a landscape and everything like that. And from there, we just built a great rapport. Man. So as I was leaving, One of the neighbors was coming. I'll never forget this. One of the neighbors was, this is all kind of fast forward. One of the neighbors was coming across the street, and you could see the look on her face when somebody's like, oh, like, not again, right? Mm-hmm. So they talk, I leave. V calls me and she's like, Cam, I don't know what you did to this lady, but she only wants to sell to you. And that then and there clicked in my head. Like, it's not about the house. Like, it is sort of about the house, right? But it's not really about the house. Like, because you're trying to buy a home, a house from somebody, and that's their home. Like, imagine if somebody came to your childhood home and was just like, hey, I want to buy this for half the price. Like, it's not about that. It's like, how are you going to help this lady? And she wanted to feel comfortable. She wanted to know that somebody was listening to her story. That's all it is.
Now that makes a great point. And you mentioned how much of a people person you are. You know, we always say people work with folks they know, like, and trust. And with the population that we're working with, if you're working with distressed property owners, mm-hmm. which is only about, you know, 5 to 6% of the folks who want to sell their property. But that's a large number in the United States specifically. That's growing. We're not growing, but always changing every single
day. And even probate is that, specifically exactly. distressed.
And that's exactly what I'm about to segue into is that people who are in distress, even though the other 94 to 95%, it may be about the price and it may be more about the property, it may be more transactional. When mm-hmm. you're out there and you're focused on wholesaling and getting deals at a discount, you have to be able to recognize that there are situations and be able to recognize situations and to mm-hmm. earn that ability to get that discounted price. You have to be willing to solve problems, as Luke mentioned in the comments, and you have to be able to listen to those issues and challenges. And it seems like you have those, you recognize you have those skills immediately. So you mm-hmm. just mentioned probate. Can you tell us why you entered the probate niche, or explain to folks what probate is and why you entered the probate niche?
So first and foremost, probate is authenticating a will, or it is a judge assigning an executor to an estate. So, you know, sometimes when you have wills, they have to authenticate it. They have to go through the probate process, which is a little shorter, but still probate. And then sometimes when no one has a will, but they have a house and estate, heirs and all that mumbo, you have to go through the process just to have an executor to be able to disperse the assets. Now, that was my first probate property, but I didn't like, it didn't resonate like, oh, probate, right? It just was like, you know, she helped me. She helped me help somebody. So then that was like first one. Then the next one was, it was Andover. And it was just a simple condo. And she's like, Cam, I think you're ready to do it yourself. I was ready because I wholetailed it, but I should have just really did it myself. Here or there.
What do you mean by hotel for someone watching who may not know these terms?
So basically, I got the property under contract. I put a little work into it, and all I really did, there was a big hole in the ceiling. I it wasn't leaking or anything, so I brought somebody from my neighborhood that I know. He patched the hole from the ceiling for like next to nothing, just a couple beers. And then I paid a bunch of kids in my area, drove them up there, and just they cleaned out the whole condo. Because it was just kind of, you know, gave them like $50 each. Oh, nice. And I got the price I wanted. Like, it was just like, okay.
Did you ever take deed? Did you ever take over title? Did you ever buy it and then put it on the listed? Or was it cleaning up, fixing it up so it looks clean and getting it out?
So, I did. So basically the way I did it, I put it under contract, but I put it under contract for like, I'll put it for like 45 days. So I had like 15 days to clean it. And then I just assigned it.
Oh, heck. Okay. I got you. Oh, awesome. Awesome. And mm-hmm. Luke's asking, did you know you knew the kids, right?
That's it. Hey, a bunch of kids in my area. Hey, you want to make $50 cleaning out a it was a one room condo. Like,
man, what we do is solve problems, bro. And every real estate transaction has 40 plus people who's involved in it. That's earning some increase from it. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. But yeah, I didn't mean to cut you off from your.
No, I love it. I love
your
it.
Journey about probate. Yeah.
Oh, so it gets deeper, right? So Andover happened. Hold on, I'm just trying to make sure I get the right timeline. And then, okay, oh, so boom. So this is my testimony as well. Okay, this is going to be a long story. And this is, I'm going to get this picture framed because this is one of those ones. So V introduces me to property in Danvers, and they had a title problem. So husband and wife owned, so this is going to be so awesome. So husband and wife own house. Wife gives rights to the husband to put it into the family trust. They didn't think he put it into the family trust, but remember that, okay? Mm-hmm. So now they give the trust to the nephew because they didn't have kids. He puts his wife on it, right? But they've been living at this house for like 40 years. Okay. And then some because the uncle, right?
Right.
So wife, well, husband dies, wife wants to sell it, which is, she's super old lady. End up dealing with her. She's trying to sell it. So I'm just trying to make sure I have the time right. So this is 5 months goes by. I'm looking for the title. I go to the registry of deeds. I'm like I'm talking like I'm looking through the actual like books from the 1800s, like peeling back pages, looking for the actual title. Right? Like I'm talking like in there looking for the title. Can't find it. So again, I've been super blessed, okay? One of the things I did, I threw a backpack giveaway for a bunch of kids in my area with one of my friends, Clarence. Mm-hmm. Just because, you know, I just wanted to give the good energy out there.
That's what's up, man.
So that happened on Saturday, okay? So now I randomly called my mentor, Nick Allerud, on Monday. And I just was like, hey, what should I do in this situation? Because I'm super discouraged at this point.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, Cam, talk to my wife. She's a title attorney, best in the area, Megan Allerud, and she'll be able to help you. I call her. She's like, Cam, another discouragement. She's like, this is why you can't quit. Another discouragement. She's like, Cam, because of the timeline, I don't know if I can handle it, but I'm going to refer you to somebody who can. So now this guy's name was Patrick Delaney. Okay. So, oh my goodness, I'm getting goosebumps right now. So then I'm talking to Patrick and he's just like, we're just talking, right? We're building rapport. And he's like, oh yeah, my dad did estates in Peabody. Now remember, Peabody up here is right next door to Danvers.
Right.
So I'm not thinking anything of it, right? Mm-hmm. That happened probably like Tuesday. So just me being proactive, I go to my seller and I'm just like, hey, Noel, why don't you go down to get like the death certificates of everybody who's owned the house and then get who wrote the estate. And then I'm just sitting there. So she does that, comes back on Thursday. And we're just talking. I'm writing everything down. And then I'm like, just fast forward. I'm like, oh, who wrote the estate? She's like, William Delaney. And I'm like, I just heard this last name.
Right.
I looked through my call list. And it's Patrick Delaney. And I'm like, let me just ask, because I know he just told me his dad did estates.
Yeah, isn't it so?
Oh, my goodness. I end up talking to his dad, ordered the title. Yeah.
So his dad was the one who did
the estate. But now, yeah. So instead of my maybe, I had my, he definitely put it into the trust. So right. Now it's just finding it. So now, in the same office, Megan Allerud, Kim Lipswich. I'm sorry, I'm butchering her name. She's so awesome, super awesome attorney. Tell her about the situation, and she refers to one of her paralegals who actually finds the title.
Wow.
Now I own the house. Now it's mine. Now it's all mine. The number's great. The number's excellent. So now, instead of wholesaling it, I was like, well, this is one of those ones where I can just go and JV the deal, which is a joint venture, which is basically you find the deal, somebody puts the money, and instead of assigning your rights to the contract, I just basically, I'll get the equity at the end when they sell it.
In as a partner. Okay.
Gotcha. Yep. So I'm in as a partner.
Man, that's a what do the numbers look like for that, if you don't mind?
So I got it for $310,000. and it needs roughly like 100 worth of work. And yeah, so the ARV is about 600 to 650.
All right, you guys holding on to it? You're going to sound like you're going to flip that, or you're going to
Well, they're going to flip it, list it, and then I'm going to, you know?
Gotcha. Yeah, that is sweet, man. It's so I hope that when you listen to this, you hear that it sounds like Cam wasn't going to quit regardless.
No.
If he had probably known all the steps and loops that he had to go through, then it may have been even more discouraging. But all you, even if you're discouraged, just keep going. And I love that you're talking about putting out good energy. When you serve, when you give, that is law. That's universe. You got
it's the universal law.
And that's a beautiful thing. Hey, I'm not gonna hold you up any further. I just, how can people, if they want to talk more to you, because I'm telling you, this guy is so accessible, so cool, so awesome. How can people reach out to you if they want to speak with you and connect?
So my name's Cameron Adesanya. I'm on Facebook. I don't use Instagram or anything like that, but my Facebook account, Cam Adesanya, Adesanya at Facebook. Well, yeah, Facebook. And yeah, I'm there. I want to start live streaming and stuff like that, just to kind of show people the process of my day, cold calls and, you know, looking at information and stuff like that, so people can understand how to do it themselves, because all this information is accessible
right here, man. So YouTube University, man, I've saved a ton of money, just like, you know, I got my new wife and I got all these honeydews, and so I'm quick to jump on YouTube to find out how to fix a sink and fix this or that, man. And so why not find out how to really spend your time? Hopefully you'll have the time anyways. Why not learn how to invest that time so you can get manyfold back for yourself, for your family? What are your big plans? What do you see yourself in like 10 years from now?
So I'm going to be an active and passive investor. Like I'm going to be in the probate space, but just for myself, I will get into some development, maybe some ground up or something like that. But I definitely want to just stay focused in probate. This year, I'm going to buy my first cash flowing asset, you know, with the funds I'm going to get from Danvers. And then just, you know, live passively.
I have that vision, brother. That's what's up. Well, man, I know it's all going to work out for you. It already is. You already are doing great things. You're great for the probate space because, I mean, you need to have a big heart to be able to serve and help people in some times that quite often can be very challenging for folks. Would you like to leave them with one? What would you like to leave folks with?
So, first of all, learn the information, right? Learn the right information, learn to get around the right people, and add value. You can't lose. It doesn't matter what you're doing. Even if you're selling cars, if you can get around the right people, you know, everything falls in line after that, because the money is fake. Like, the money is fake. And I know it's super tough to say that, but trust me, I'm from the same place. Like, the money is fake. It's not real. It's not like you can eat it. Like Pablo Escobar, he burned $1 million to keep his daughter warm.
Yeah, man.
Like, so if somebody said, if I was to give you $1 million right now, right? And no strings attached, you take it, right? But if I said, here's $1 million, you're not going to wake up tomorrow, would you take it?
Right, right, exactly.
So it's like, yeah, that next day is worth everything, because, you know.
That, man. Yeah, brother, I really feel you on that, man. The byproduct of serving is happiness, and it can be the funds, because what money can do is amazing for folks out there. But there's some things that money can't buy, and being able to serve and be fulfilled is an amazing thing, man. It's great that Uncle appreciate you sharing your journey with folks, and I look forward to continue to see what you're doing and being part of your journey, and man, it's awesome. So I appreciate you being on this Life in Transitions Experts podcast. I always end it with Life in Transitions Experts, LITE, just like Cam's doing, let your light shine.
Thank you, man. I really appreciate you for having me, and I just appreciate what you're doing.
Oh, appreciate you, brother. It's all great. I appreciate you being able to let's share, man. Heck yeah. I'm in the stream right